Good morning, everyone. And welcome to worship today. Whether you are at home watching here in the sanctuary, you are most welcome in this time and in this space. I only have one announcement this morning, and that is there is going to be work done in the parking lot starting on Saturday, June 5th. And so you will probably not be able to use the parking lot for several weeks while work is being done. So plan for that. Plan to use the office entrance on Prairie Street to come in for service. So, and it'll clearly be marked off. So that is my one and only announcement. So friends, would you please join me in the call to worship? Let us worship the triune God. Let us worship the one who spoke in the beginning and created something out of nothing. Let us worship the triune God. Let us worship the one who took on the clothing of humanity to set those who were oppressed free. Let us worship the triune God. Let us worship the one whose spirit rests continually upon us, calling us from sorrow-filled endings to bright new beginnings. Would you please stand in body or in spirit as you are able and join me as we sing God the Sculptor of the Mountains. Be seated. This morning I light this candle in honor of every single one of you, in honor of all of us who are worshiping together, knowing that no matter where we are, no matter how we worship, we are still united in the light and the love of Christ. So we're going to try our ASL, peace be with you, okay? So may the peace be with you and also with you, all right? So share a sign of peace with one another and make sure to wave to the side camera and say hi to everyone watching at home. Our psalm reading today is Psalm 29. It's a psalm of David which acknowledges the Lord's might in the storms that we face. Ascribe to the Lord, O heavenly beings, ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory of his name. Worship the Lord in holy splendor. The voice of the Lord is over the waters, the God of glory thunders. The Lord over mighty waters. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is full of majesty. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedars. The Lord breaks the cedars of Lebanon. He makes Lebanon skip like a calf and Syrian like a young wild ox. The voice of the Lord flashes forth flames of fire. The voice of the Lord shakes the wilderness. The Lord shakes the wilderness of Kadesh. The voice of the Lord causes the oaks to whirl and strips the forests bare. And in his temple, all say, glory. The Lord sits enthroned over the flood. The Lord sits enthroned as king forever. May the Lord give strength to his people. May the Lord bless his people with peace. Amen. As we come now to a time of confession, we confess knowing that, yes, we have fallen short of God's glory, but we also confess knowing that God's grace holds us, that we have nothing to fear because God loves us and is with us forevermore. Would you pray with me our prayer to confession? Holy and triune God, you alone live in perfect relationship, one God in three persons, mutual and loving, ever seeking reconciliation and unity. You have called us to live in your completion, yet we confess that our relationships are imperfect and we are incomplete without you. We are selfish and greedy. We are anxious and resentful. We feel the shame of our foolish behavior and brokenness. We have allowed sin to drive us apart from one another and from you. Forgive us and restore us. Draw us close and bind us together in your mercy. May we long for wholeness and peace. May we strive toward gratitude and grace in the saving name of your Son, Jesus Christ, by the working power of your Holy Spirit. Amen. Here in this moment and in this place, the spirit of gentleness moves in our midst. Mercy, hope, and joy are the gifts of God to each one of us. No longer lost, we have found our way home, surrounded by God's peace, by God's grace, by God's love. We are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Let us sing now our response to forgiveness. Halle, halle, hallelujah. Give me just a second, y'all. I realize that I meant to read our scripture in a different translation, and of course, I still have my other Bible. So give me a second as I use the magic of the internet to look it up very quickly. It made more sense to me in this translation. So if you want to know what translation it is, it's called the Common English Bible, and this is a translation that is fairly recent, I think within the last 10 years, that puts the Bible into more modern English. So how we would actually talk in the 21st century. So, hear now though these words from Romans chapter 8, verses 1 through 17. So now there isn't any condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. The law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. God has done what was impossible for the law, since it was weak because of selfishness. God condemned sin in the body by sending his own Son to deal with sin in the same body as humans, who are controlled by sin. He did this so that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us. Now, the way we live is based on the Spirit, not based on selfishness. People whose lives are based on selfishness think about selfish things. But people whose lives are based on the Spirit think about things that are related to the Spirit. The attitude that comes from selfishness leads to death, but the attitude that comes from the Spirit leads to life and peace. So the attitude that comes from selfishness is hostile to God. It doesn't submit to God's law because it can't. People who are self-centered aren't able to please God. But you aren't self-centered. Instead, you are in the Spirit if, in fact, God's Spirit lives in you. If anyone doesn't have the Spirit of Christ, they don't belong to him. But if Christ is in you, the Spirit is your life. Because God's righteousness, but the body is dead because of sin. If the Spirit of the one who raised Jesus from the dead lives in you, then the one who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your human bodies also, through the Spirit that lives in you. So then, brothers and sisters, we have an obligation, but it isn't an obligation to ourselves to live our lives on the basis of selfishness. If you live on the basis of selfishness, you are going to die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the actions of the body, you will live. All who are led by God's Spirit are God's children. You didn't receive a spirit of slavery to lead you back again into fear, but you received a spirit that shows that you are adopted as God's children. With the Spirit, we cry, Abba, Father. The same Spirit agrees with our spirit that we are God's children. But if we are children, we are also heirs. We are God's heirs and fellow heirs with Christ if we really suffer with him so that we can also be glorified with him. Friends, this is God's word for us today. Please pray with me. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable unto you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So this is a pretty dense passage from the book of Romans. Paul does not write things that are easily interpreted. Paul does not seem to write for our own mindset, right? But let's try to unpack what he's saying. So Paul is really influenced by the time in which he lives. He's really influenced by the Greek philosophers. And for the Greek philosophers, there was a clear difference between your earthly human form and your spiritual form. And so you had the flesh, and you had the spirit, you had the body, you had the soul, and there was a line between them. And so Paul's writings kind of play into that back and forth between the body and the soul. Between what is of earth and what is of God. What is fragile and frail and will die and pass away, and what is eternal and strong and has life everlasting. And this kind of back and forth is where we find ourselves in this Romans chapter 8. Because Paul is telling the people who are listening, the Romans, he's telling them, look, up until this point, before you knew Christ, before you had heard about Jesus, you were selfish. Traditional translations say you lived by the flesh. But I like this idea of selfishness. I think it gets more to the heart of it. You were selfish. You lived just for your own benefit. You wanted something, you went and got it. You didn't feel like helping a neighbor in need, you ignored them. You followed whatever it was that you wanted in the moment. It's a momentary, fleeting kind of living that Paul is talking about. And I think that's really at the heart of what he's saying. And he's saying that when we live in our own selfish bubbles, when we live that way, we cut ourselves off from who we could be in Christ. We set ourselves apart from the Spirit of God which lives in each of us. When we choose selfishness, when we choose our own benefit above all others, what happens is that the people around us begin to suffer and we put on blinders and act like we can't tell. And of course, we all know that selfishness is one of those things that has never gone out of style in the human condition. We are still pretty selfish people. And honestly, one of the things that I think of when I think of it are the corporate billionaires of America. Friends, I don't know how to spend $1 billion in a lifetime. But what I do know is that wealth hoarding puts on blinders to our neighbors who are in poverty. When we hoard resources, like remember at the start of COVID, at the start of the pandemic, when everyone bought toilet paper, and then you couldn't find toilet paper anywhere? That's the kind of selfishness that Paul is talking about. When we start hoarding resources, whether it be wealth or food or toilet paper or just our own personal space, our own personal priorities, we start to live according to our own selfishness, our fleeting whims. Because guess what? Basically is what Paul is saying. Guess what? All that wealth that you accumulate, all that toilet paper that's stocked up in your backyard or in your garage, all of this stuff that you have, it doesn't go with you. Right? There is nothing here on earth that is going with us into the afterlife except our souls. The Spirit of the living God is what goes with us. Our spirits, which are united with Christ, go with us into the afterlife. Everything else stays here. So it doesn't matter how much wealth you hoard or how many goods you hoard or how much you keep to yourself and put on blinders and say, I don't notice all of these people in need around me. I only care about number one right here. It doesn't go with you. And Paul is telling the Romans and telling us, look, you can choose to live that way. But that's the way of death. Because when you die, everything else goes with you. There is no more money. There is no more toilet paper hoarding. There is no more any of that. It just stops. It ends. It ceases. But when we choose life, we're choosing life not just here in this moment. We are choosing life eternal. And life eternal says we don't hoard in the moment. We give to our neighbor in need so that we all have more than enough. Because there is more than enough to go around. Like just even a couple of weeks ago, when the East Coast faced a gas shortage. Friends, it wasn't a real gas shortage. It was just take only what you need so there is enough for the person who comes next. And then suddenly people were filling plastic bags with gasoline. And there was no point. There was no reason other than living for selfishness. But when we live for life, we are living for life here and in the hereafter. We are living for life abundant, not just for us, but for our neighbors, for the ones that we love, for the strangers that we have yet to meet. We are living for them because God's Spirit is within us, and it is God who begins to guide us. And that Spirit of God leads us away from selfishness and toward community. Because we are all one in Christ's body. We are all one, united in Christ's Spirit. Then we live. We live together. Sharing is one of the first lessons we learn as children. But so often it's a lesson that as adults we forget. And we're bad at it. But when we have the Spirit of Christ, when we have that Spirit of God living and moving and breathing within us, then we begin to learn about the glory and the beauty that is the community that God has given us. We remember that we are in this fight all together, that life is hard for all of us. At some point, every single one of us has a need. Every single one of us runs into trials and tribulations, and we suffer, and we fall, and we need one another to be lifted back up, to keep going together, to have life together. So, friends, we have an obligation to life. An obligation to life abundant here now, and an obligation to life everlasting with the Almighty. And that obligation to life starts with us saying, I'm not going to be selfish. God, help me when I am. That obligation to life says, there is so much good that we can do in this world when we come together and work together and are united in God's Holy Spirit. So let us work for the good of God's kingdom here and hereafter. Let's start the work now. Let's build God's kingdom here on earth, so that no one goes without, but everyone has more than enough. so that we can all have life. We can all support one another. We can all go to bed with stomachs full of food, to have peaceful dreams, not worrying about if we'll have a roof over our head next week. This is the life that God is calling us to care for one another, and know that we'll be cared for in return because we are united now and forever in the holy light of Christ. Amen. Please pray with me. Most holy God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we lift up our prayers to you. Lord, this is Memorial Day weekend, where we honor and remember those who were not selfish, but who gave their lives for a cause greater than themselves. Be with all families who mourn this weekend. Lord, we know that so often Memorial Day is the beginning of summer in America. It's the start of our new season. And Lord, I pray for all of those children who are out of school for summer, that they would be safe, that they would have fun, that they would have enough to eat when the cafeterias at school are closed. We pray, O Lord, for those who are traveling, that they might be safe upon the roads, that they will have great adventures and see new things and experience your world, your creation in a new and vibrant way. And Lord, I pray for peace. As we remember those who fought and died for a cause greater than themselves, Lord, may we find a way as humanity that no more will have to die. May we find a way forward as humanity, as your children created in your image, to live together, so that our true gift to those who have died might be peace everlasting. We especially pray for the Middle East and for Israel and Gaza, that there might be peace and justice. Lord, as we begin our summers, go with us. Show us places where we can be your hands and your feet in this world, where we can choose to live in your spirit and set aside our selfishness for the sake of our neighbors. Lord, we lift up all of our prayers in the name of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us how to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, would you please stand as you are able in body or in spirit and join me on this Trinity Sunday as we affirm our faith together, saying the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. One pastor's note before we sing our final hymn. I had someone ask me this week, why do we say I believe in the Holy Catholic Church? The word Catholic with a little c means unified or united. So we always believe in the church unified, no matter what. Let us sing, Holy, Holy, Holy. This blessing. God, our life sends us out in these moments, and so we go to bind ourselves to those who hunger, to those who search for a home. God, our hope sends us out in these moments, so we go to bind ourselves to those who live in the shadows, to those who long for companionship. God, our peace sends us out in these moments, so we go to bind ourselves to those who are forgotten, to embrace those who are pushed aside by hate and anger. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, go now in peace. Amen.